the second of Dr. Smith's group from the biology department.
All right, so we thought we'd begin with a little bit of an icebreaker. So, what did that video show us? Well, it showed us high speed allows us to see things that we wouldn't otherwise see with the naked eye. For example, a gun firing, or taken in a biological context, a snake striking, or a hummingbird flapping its wings. Now, this led us to wonder what other behaviors could be further explained by high speed. And we began thinking of animals that we could look at, and we ultimately decided on frogs because their behavior of jumping is something that's characteristic of them, and it looks pretty interesting under high speed. But then we took that and wondered what we could do to alter that behavior, and we ultimately ended up with testing the effects of jumping, or the effects of alcohol on jumping performance in run amphibians. So why alcohol? Well, we chose alcohol because alcohol acts as, it is a contaminant. And in this context, any toxin that would be in an environment would be too dangerous for frogs. It would end up killing them. So alcohol is something that has documented effects on behavior, and it's fairly safe to work with animals. It doesn't show any permanent damage. Amphibians and frogs and other amphibians alike have permeable skin, which makes them very susceptible to toxins in their environment. So if something is in the water, if it's in the air, if it's in the soil, it's going to be absorbed by frogs. And there's been a lot of research to show that this can have an effect on development, such as this picture right here. You see the frog with several legs. But there hasn't been much done to document how that affects different behaviors in frogs or performances. We chose to work with leopard frogs because leopard frogs live across the country, and oftentimes they live side by side with humans. There's also a vast amount of research done with leopard frogs, but none really regarding performance. So that's what we decided to do with our study.
Okay, so we predicted that the frogs that were treated with the ethanol would have an impaired jumping ability than those that were just treated with plain deionized water. We expected that they would not jump as far, they would have a decreased horizontal displacement, they would also not jump as high, therefore the takeoff angle would also be smaller. They would also have a lower takeoff velocity and an increase in contact time, which is the time from which there was the first sign of movement after the stimulus to the highest point in their jump. And the three here, vertical displacement, takeoff angle, and contact time, we found to be statistically significant, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. Okay, so we received the frogs and we placed them in individual bins. They had 900 milliliters of water each and were slightly angled, that way they would have some dry area in those bins. We also fed and cleaned them biweekly. During the experiment, we created a light apparatus. It had four 12,500 lumen LED light bars, very bright. It also was low heat, so that way it wouldn't impact the frog by drying it out anyway. There was also a non-slip mat, so that way it would have friction for its jump. We also had a high-speed camera and a white background that had a grid and millimeters on it, so that way the software that we use, we can make those measurements. Okay, so right here is a picture of one of our, well, of all the frogs, but the experimental group, we had a solution of 3 milliliters of the ethanol to 190 milliliters of the deionized water, and we would let them absorb cutaneous absorption in those watch glasses for 30 minutes before we tested them jumping. We also used a rod as a stimulus to provoke them for their jump. And the high-speed camera recorded at 500 frames per second, which significantly slowed that down. If you think about your average video, it's 60 frames per second, so it was a lot slower. The shutter speed was also 1/10,000th of a second, which was for clarity and resolution of video. And we analyzed our data with Tracker and Jeremy. And so here is an example of one of our videos of the control frog. Notice that its jump was very, very high and has a good angle. We'll compare it to one of the alcohol frogs.
So once we analyzed all of our videos and collected data, we came up with the three significant findings. The main one being the takeoff angle in the experimental group was significantly decreased from the control group. As you can see, the experimental group had almost half of the takeoff angle that the control group had. Another finding was the vertical displacement. The experimental group had only a quarter of the height that the control group was able to attain. And then contact time was also significantly decreased between the two groups, with the experimental group having lower contact time. Now, this is in opposition with what we had predicted. We were expecting the alcohol to slow down reaction time with the frogs and making them slow down the jump process to their maximum height. But what we found with the decreased height and the angle was that they weren't in the air for as long of a time because they didn't attain as great of a height as the control group. And this is just a video of one of our experimental frogs. You can see it's more of a hop than a legitimate jump. So our conclusions are that ethanol does affect vertical displacement, contact time, and takeoff angle during a jump. There was no significant difference in horizontal displacement or takeoff velocity, meaning that they're able to jump as far and with as much speed as the control group. The reason this is relevant is because, as previously stated, frogs act as key indicators for environmental health. And there have been a lot of studies looking at how pollutants affect the development of a frog, but none studying the effect of a fully developed behavior in mature frogs. So that's what we wanted to test. And specifically, we were testing the escape behavior of frogs, jumping being how they get away from a predator. And based on our results, we can conclude that the affected frogs would be in the air for a less amount of time, and they'd be occupying less three-dimensional space during their jump, making it easier for them to be caught by a predator. And this would affect the fitness of a frog and could possibly lead to population decrease in environments that need to be maintained. So this is bringing all that together. The frogs act as Seth stated, they act as watchdogs for how the environment health is, and that could eventually work its way up the food chain from pollutants all the way up to humans. So if we're not watching how frogs are behaving in the environment, then we need to be taking action to try to clean up the environment and prevent any more contaminants being introduced.
How did you elicit the frogs to jump? Did you just kind of naturally wait for them to jump, or did you give some type of stop signal or some type of visual cue?
We had a little stick that we poked them with.
The alcohol group actually didn't really require any kind of provocation. A lot of them just jumped naturally before we were even ready a lot of times, so we had to make sure they were in place and we were ready for them to go.
Anybody?
Go ahead.
I was just curious how long the effects of the ethanol lasted.
We didn't really study how long the effects. We kind of used the frogs for our trials, then we allowed them to soak in DI water and kind of flush that alcohol off their system to prevent any damage to the animal.
Yeah.
that's kind of related to my question. So then after they have lost the effects of the alcohol, do you test them again and see that they go back into the control group? I mean, do their jumps come back?
No, we tested them once. We had two different groups, 9 frogs in our control group and 8 in the experimental group. And they were all tested once, and then they were kind of let to recuperate.
Do you say that you kept the frogs in distilled water?
We kept them in DI water, and we monitored the pH to make sure that there would be nothing else to could affect the frog. We just wanted to test that contaminant alone, so we tried our best to isolate that as much as possible.
And what about out in the real world? How similar is that water to their life just being around in the corn farm?
It really depends on the region. Because they live in so many different places across the country, it depends on the particular region.
Of course, it won't be that clean of nutrients and other molecules.